September 16th, 1920. New York City. In the heart of the financial district, a horse-drawn wagon pulls up outside the offices of J.P. Morgan Bank at 23 Wall Street. Hidden in the cart are 100 pounds of dynamite and 500 pounds of cast iron weights. A timer is set. As the driver disappears into the crowd, the bomb detonates. The explosion is so powerful that it knocks a trolley from its tracks several blocks away. The bombing on Wall Street was the culmination of an ill-fated revolutionary strategy known as propaganda by the deed. Fifty years earlier, in 1871, a mass uprising occurred in Paris. 2 million people established dozens of worker cooperatives, electing delegates to represent them instead of politicians. Everyone, no matter how poor, had a say in the running of their society. The experiment, which became known as the Paris Commune, was brutally crushed. After being overrun by French soldiers, tens of thousands of Parisians were slaughtered. Karl Marx wrote of the violence in Paris. The civilization and justice of bourgeois order comes out in its lurid light whenever the slaves and drudges of that order rise against their masters. Then, this civilization and justice stand forth as undisguised savagery and lawless revenge. The Paris Commune was heavily influenced by anarchism, and in its aftermath, anarchists throughout Europe were driven underground. Though most remained nonviolent, a small number turned to terrorism. Their targets included police chiefs, business leaders, politicians, and royalty. Their goal: to inspire the masses to revolution. Propaganda by the deed emerged in the United States under similar conditions of mass poverty and state violence. In the late 19th century, working people lived a meager existence of poverty, degradation, and toil. Most were paid subsistence or less than subsistence wages. Safety protections in the workplace were minimal or non-existent. Child labor was rampant, and living conditions were increasingly horrid. When workers tried to organize, they were met with violence. Their oppressors included police, vigilantes, private detectives, and even federal troops. According to historian Philip Taft, the United States, at the turn of the century, became home of the bloodiest and most violent labor history of any industrial nation in the world. Dynamite, invented in 1862, offered a new and terrifying weapon for both sides. The German immigrant and anarchist Johann Mos wrote, "In giving dynamite to the downtrodden millions of the globe, science has done its best work. A pound of this stuff beats a bushel of ballots all hollow." Bombings were also used in treacherous false flag operations designed to portray all dissidents as dangerous criminals. During the Lawrence textile strike of 1912, the owner of the company, William Madison Wood, hired a local undertaker to plant dynamite around the city with the goal of framing the union leadership. And in 1916, two labor leaders, Thomas Mooney and Warren Billings, were framed for the bombing of a military parade in San Francisco. The two men were pardoned after spending over 20 years in prison for a crime they didn't commit. During World War I and the subsequent Red Scare, the federal government began a massive surveillance campaign against American citizens. The budget of the Bureau of Investigation, founded in 1908 with only 34 employees, underwent a sevenfold increase. A new radical division was created. It quickly produced a remarkable 200,000 cross-index cards on 60,000 activists across the country. The primary targets were socialists and anarchists. Under the Palmer Raids, thousands of American citizens were arrested and detained under conditions a later judicial report characterized as grossly unconstitutional. Hundreds were deported. The raids were given justification by a bombing campaign allegedly carried out by a cadre of anarchists, mostly Italian immigrants. Attorney General Palmer himself was one of the targets.
There were, of course, different factions among radicals in the United States. And they, to some degree, they fought one another. But mainly what they were fighting was the capitalist system and the police authorities and the corporate spies, the industrial spies, that stood in the way of a more just society. One of the particular flavors, if you will, of that battle were the Italian anarchists known as Gallianists. And they favored an approach to struggle that would later be called a single spark approach, or sometimes it was called propaganda of the deed. And the gist of this was that a secret cadre, a little group, 5-10 people, would bomb something. They would blow up a stock exchange, they'd blow up a bank, and in this way, the idea was that they would set off a revolution in which millions of people would come to participate, and that that subsequent stage of a revolution would give birth to a genuinely new society. Well, it didn't work. It didn't happen that way. The people who favored that approach, many of them lost their lives, many of them gave their lives to pursue that concept of social revolution.
In April 1919, a number of package bombs were intercepted by police. Among the targets were John D. Rockefeller Jr. and J.P. Morgan Jr. Morgan's bank was the target of the 1920 bombing on Wall Street. 38 people were killed and hundreds more injured during the attack. Yet Morgan himself was not among them. Most of the victims were themselves members of the working or middle classes, messengers, stenographers, clerks, and low-level brokers. The crime remains unsolved to this day. According to the Bureau of Investigation, The culprit was most likely Mario Buda, an anarchist who fled to Italy after the bombing. Buda was reportedly enraged by the arrests of Nicola Sacco and Bartolomeo Vincetti, two Italian-born anarchists who were charged and convicted of murdering two men during the robbery of a shoe company. The evidence against the two immigrants was slim, but widespread anti-immigrant sentiment prevented a fair trial. The case became an international cause célèbre, with figures such as H.G. Wells, George Bernard Shaw, and Albert Einstein urging a retrial. It never came. Sacco and Vincetti were executed by electric chair in 1927 at Charleston State Prison. The case had received so much attention in the labor press that protests and wildcat strikes erupted around the world.
Two good men's a long time gone. Two good men's a long time gone. Two good men's a long time gone. Left me here to sing this song. Sacco's wife, three children had. Sacco was a family man. Vanzetti was a dreaming man. His book is always in his hands. Sacco earned his bread and butter being the factory's best shoe cutter. Vanzetti spoke both day and night, told the workers how to fight. Two good men a long time gone. Two good men a long time gone. Two good men a long time gone. Left me here to sing this song. I'll tell you if you ask me about this payroll robbery. Two clerks is killed by the shoe factory on the street in South Braintree. Judge there told his friends around that he had cut the radicals down. Anarchist bastard was the name Judge Thayer called these two good men. I'll tell you the prosecutor's name, Katzman Adams Williams Kane. The judge and lawyer strutted down, they done more tricks than circus clowns. Two good men's a long time gone. Two good men's a long time gone.
For their part, the two accused maintained their innocence until the end. In his statement before the court, Vincetti declared, "I never committed a crime in my life. I have never stole, and I have never killed, and I have never spilt blood. I fought against crime, and I have sacrificed myself even to eliminate the crimes the law and the church legitimate and sanctify. My conviction is that I have suffered for things I am guilty of. I am suffering because I am a radical. And indeed, I am a radical. I have suffered because I was an Italian, and indeed, I am an Italian. If you could execute me two times, and if I could be reborn two other times, I would live again to do what I have done already." One year after the bombing of Wall Street, coal miners in the heart of West Virginia engaged in an all-out revolt against the state government. Their plan was to establish fair labor practices and safety standards, unionize the entire region, and release miners imprisoned under martial law statutes. Conditions for miners in early 20th century America were grim. In company towns, 12-hour workdays were the norm. Workers frequently became ill with black lung disease. Catastrophic accidents took thousands of lives. And what little pay they received was only redeemable at the company store. A common complaint was that mules were treated better than workers themselves. Mules were considered valuable company property, whereas workers were entirely expendable. When miners attempted to unionize, they were evicted from their homes. If they stayed, they were subjected to violence by private goon squads. The uprising in West Virginia was sparked by the murder of Sid Hatfield, a police chief in the town of Matewan, who had made the rare move of siding with the workers against the coal companies. On May 19th of the previous year, Hatfield and several of his deputies engaged in a shootout with Baldwin Felt's gunmen sent in to evict strikers and their families. In September 1921, some 15,000 miners took up arms. It was the largest armed uprising in the United States since the Civil War. The majority of the fighting took place on Blair Mountain, where workers squared off against militia and police. Coal companies went so far as to hire airplanes to drop explosives full of shrapnel on the rebels. The battle lasted for 5 days. Just as it seemed the rebel army might prevail, President Warren G. Harding sent in federal troops from Fort Thomas, Kentucky. Many of the miners had fought in World War I and refused to engage American soldiers. After surrendering, over 1,200 indictments were laid down, including 325 for murder and 24 for treason. The public was sympathetic to the accused. Of the men convicted, most only served a few years in prison. All told, between 50 and 100 miners were killed and hundreds more wounded during the Battle of Blair Mountain. 30 deaths were reported on the side of the coal companies. 2 years after the battle in West Virginia, American labor would again suffer a major defeat, this time in San Pedro, California. Longshoremen were upset both by low wages and attempts to criminalize union organizing under the Criminal Syndicalism Act, a relic of the Red Scare. On April 25th, 1923, several thousand dock workers walked off the job. Huge sympathy walkouts also occurred on the East Coast. After 100 ships were tied up in the port of Los Angeles, police moved in to round up union leaders. At that point, the industrial workers of the world called for a citywide strike. The industrial workers of the world, also known as the Wobblies, were one of the few unions from the time period that rejected divisions based on race, sex, and skill. Embracing a nonviolent but revolutionary strategy known as anarcho-syndicalism, they had come under repeated attacks by authorities from the time of their founding in 1905. During World War I and the Red Scare, their offices were raided, and some of their members given prison sentences of up to 20 years. Several Wobblies, such as Frank Little, were lynched by vigilantes. The Wobblies never recovered from these assaults. By the 1920s, many of their most effective organizers were either dead, deported, or languishing in prison, and their numbers had begun to decline. In San Pedro, they not only had to fight the police, but the Ku Klux Klan.
The Ku Klux Klan was reinvented by the federal government, literally, by Woodrow Wilson. It had come out of after the Civil War as a fascist, reactionary, terrorist group to create Jim Crow, and it was successful at that. And then all of the offices, every local office, the governorship, senators, and congressmen, they were all Jim Crow, you know, segregationists. So they didn't need the Klan anymore. You can really trace the reinvention with the Birth of a Nation, which was first of all a novel by a segregationist, and then it was made into a blockbuster silent movie in the early days of silent movies, Birth of a Nation, D.W. Griffith. These people, both the author of the book and the filmmaker, were good friends of Woodrow Wilson, who was a segregationist, and that movie was premiered in the White House, and it was lines around the block in every town and city in the country of people seeing that movie. It's a racial hatred movie that depicts the righteousness of the Ku Klux Klan. It's about the early Klan. So this, took off. People started forming clans. The Klan was literally recreated. You know, from my work in Central America in the 1980s, and the formation of death squads in El Salvador and Guatemala, I looked at that and I said, that's the purpose the Klan served. It was a parallel institution of the police in Central America. They wore masks, but they were often just army people, doing this at night and with a full green light from the authorities.
Only 1 year before the strike in San Pedro, Los Angeles District Attorney Thomas Lee Woolwine raided Klan headquarters and seized their records. He was shocked to discover that the head of the LAPD, Louis D. Oakes, was himself a member. It was a nationwide problem. The Portland Telegram reported that the police bureau was full to the brink with Klansmen, while in Colorado, KKK members included several state senators, the Secretary of State, four judges, and scores of police. In San Pedro, members of the Klan arrived in gangs to intimidate strikers on the docks, both with and without their hoods. In response, workers began to assemble on a parcel of land overlooking the harbor. They named it Liberty Hill. One frequent speaker was the Los Angeles-based writer and socialist Upton Sinclair, author of the 1906 novel, The Jungle. The book's vivid exposés of the brutal working conditions and unhygienic practices in American meat plants had led to reforms in the industry. On May 15th, on Liberty Hill, Sinclair read the First Amendment to the American Constitution. Before he could finish, he was arrested by the LAPD. 3 days later, 71 Wobblies were arrested and jailed, while 500 scabs were granted full employment on the docks. The strike had been defeated. The Wobblies continued to agitate in San Pedro, and the Klan continued to assault them. In 1924, the union held a benefit for workers who had died in a railroad accident. Masked Klansmen burst into the meeting hall and assaulted men, women, and children. Two children, Andrew Kruglis and May Sunstead, were severely burned when the attackers threw boiling water at them from a coffee pot. Sunstead's mother, a poor washerwoman named Lisa, died from injuries sustained during the assault. The 1923 San Pedro strike is recognized by labor historians as the biggest challenge to anti-unionism in Los Angeles prior to the 1930s. However, its failure also signified the decline of the Wobblies, as well as the broader anarchist movement in the United States. After the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia, working people increasingly looked to communism as a means of freeing themselves from the yoke of wage slavery.
During the era of World War I, many of the leading anarchist speakers, writers, editors were imprisoned or deported. So in the years after that, in the 1920s and the 1930s, the anarchist movement in the United States declined. Partially that was because some of the leaders had been taken out of the movement in the Red Scare period around World War I, but it was also because they were facing a number of other challenges. Of course, in 1917, the Russian Revolution occurred, and this gave birth to the rise of the communist movement internationally. And there was a communist party formed in the United States due to the victory, what seemed to be a real achievement of the first workers' state in Russia, and what would later become the Soviet Union. Many radical workers in the United States were drawn to this new movement, the Communist Party, were drawn away from the anarchist movement. In the mid-1920s, the industrial workers of the world started to go into decline. There were fights within it as to whether the IWW should align with the Communist Party and become part of the Communist movement, or if it should be independent and retain its anarcho-syndicalist features. Another challenge that anarchists faced was the rise of fascism in Europe during the 1920s. So in the 20s and the 30s, we saw the rise of Mussolini in Italy and Hitler in Germany. Anarchists had always believed in internationalism. They wanted to unite the working class of different nations. And as we have said, the anarchists in the United States were often immigrants from Europe, so they had close family and personal ties to working people in Italy and Germany, elsewhere. In the 1920s and the 1930s, U.S. anarchists put a lot of effort into fundraising and doing other forms of support for prisoners in the Soviet Union, in Germany, in Italy, and trying to build support for the anarchist movement in these other countries. This made it difficult for them to put the required amount of resources into organizing workers in the United States.
Prior to its eventual decline, the Socialist Party of America offered a powerful vehicle for democratic reform in the United States. At various times since their founding in 1901, their members had included mayors, representatives from local offices, and even two congressmen. Their leader, Eugene Debs, received almost 1 million votes during the presidential election of 1912. Debs was imprisoned after the passage of the Draconian Espionage Act of World War I for speaking out against the war. "I would rather be shot as a traitor than go to war for Wall Street," he declared. Debs audaciously ran for president while behind bars during the election of 1920. He died 6 years later after being released on humanitarian grounds. In 1919, 2 years after the Bolshevik Revolution, the Socialist Party held its annual convention. A crisis occurred when a majority voted to support the revolution in Russia and established direct contact with the Comintern, an international organization advocating world communism. The SP's leadership, which supported democratic reform rather than the direct seizure of power, then expelled two-thirds of its own members. By 1929, the Socialist Party's membership had declined to only 6,000 people. Taking its place was the American Communist Party.
You know, I think that this period of the 19-teens was a period of industrial violence, a period of considerable class conflict with dimensions of racial and nativist or anti-immigrant conflict. It's all there. We also see the development of radical ideas. How could we have not just a decent wage, how could we have good work? How could we have work even that goes beyond not damaging us to work that allows us to develop as human beings? How could we live in communities in which people cared for each other and took care and looked after each other? How could we live with dignity and self-respect? And so these ideas, many of which receive cultural expressions in visual art, in theater, in music, these ideas are really burbling around in the United States. And in the midst of all of that, the Russian Revolution happens. And so the Communist Party, as it would take shape in the United States, and initially it was called the Workers' Party, and then later in the mid-1920s it took the name the Communist Party, that the Workers' Party became a place where workers went to learn about. So what had happened in Russia? How did they do it there? You know, I think we often think other people must know how to do something better than we do because we're not succeeding at making things very much better. And so they had a lot of cachet because they were associated with the Russian Revolution and the seeming success of the Russian Revolution. Over the years, that would become a mixed blessing, that when there would be this huge conflict in the Soviet Union between Stalin on the one hand and Trotsky on the other, that would divide people who saw themselves as communists in the United States, and some would side with one and some would side with the other. And then later in the 20th century, when people would become more aware that the Soviet Union had created a new kind of inequality and new kinds of absences of freedom, and people who had considered themselves to be communists went through great internal angst about how could we have supported that. And so there was something to be gained by having identified with this, and over time there would also be something to lose.
In the early 1920s, the Soviet Union came into official existence. And so this communist revolution reverberated throughout the world, and in America, capitalists were very fearful that a revolution might occur here. After World War I, businesses cut back on a lot of the production, union organizers were fired, and a huge strike wave followed the war. 1919 saw tremendous strikes. The Boston Police Force went on strike in 1919. Steelworkers, nearly a million steelworkers, went on strike in 1919. There was a general strike in Seattle. And the strike wave was accompanied by a rash of anarchist bombings. And in self-defense, unions began to proclaim that they were very patriotic and very American, quote-unquote American. And they excised a lot of their radical element.
During the AFL's 1923 convention, its leadership drove out the sole communist delegate, William Dunn. In 1923, the leadership of the United Mine Workers expelled all communists from its union. In 1924 and 25, the carpenters and machinists unions followed suit. Yet by destroying their left flank, unions would increasingly become paper tigers. The most passionate and effective organizers were almost invariably radicals, and business leaders continued to paint union members as dangerous subversives, regardless of their political beliefs. The National Association of Manufacturers spread propaganda that unionism in any form was linked to communist activities, while Bethlehem Steel refused to sell its product to contractors who were so unpatriotic as to hire union labor. The AFL was also hamstrung by its exclusive focus on skilled workers, even as workplaces had become increasingly diverse and mechanized. By 1928, the American Federation of Labor had lost 1 million members. By 1929, the United Textile Workers represented less than 3% of the 1.1 million workers in that industry. Over 600,000 workers took part in more than 1,000 strikes between 1922 and 1926, but the majority ended in defeat. Increasingly, employers chose to move production south rather than tolerate union activity at all. Despite popular belief, the harsh racial divide in the South did not actually benefit white workers as a whole. A 1928 Bureau of Labor study of 17 occupations estimated that hourly wages were 43% lower in the South than in the North. Child labor remained. Congress had passed laws in 1918 and 1922 attempting to eliminate the exploitation of children. However, the Supreme Court ruled that such reforms were a violation of the so-called liberty of contract. A similar decision was made about minimum wage laws in the court's 1923 decision, Adkins versus Children's Hospital. Income tax rates for the wealthiest Americans fell from 77% during World War I to just 25% in its aftermath. By the end of the 1920s, the largest American corporations owned nearly half of the nation's wealth.
Conscience dulled by demon rum, liquor, thy name's delirium. Tomorrow we awaken to a new dawn.
In 1920, prohibition became the law of the land. The American Constitution was amended to include a ban on alcoholic beverages. Supported by a coalition of law and order conservatives and social progressives, prohibition had existed in some states since the 19th century. The most effective lobbying groups were the Anti-Saloon League and the Women's Christian Temperance Union. The WCTU was founded by Frances Willard, an early champion of women's education, women's suffrage, and progressive reforms like the 8-hour workday. However, like many progressives from the time period, she was a racist, claiming that the colored race multiplies like the locusts of Egypt. Also, like many progressives, Willard expressed an elitist contempt for the working class, especially working class men. For male workers, the saloon was an oasis where they could escape the drudgery of their everyday lives. For Willard, it was nothing more than a den of debauchery. Widespread alcoholism was a real issue affecting Americans, but the prohibition experiment would create more problems than it solved. A study of more than 30 major cities in 1920 and 1921 found that theft and burglaries had increased by 9%, homicides by 12%, assaults and battery by 13%, and drug addiction by 44%. As organized crime exploded, police departments used street violence as a pretext to expand their own reach and power, even as they often worked with the very criminals they were paid to fight.
By now, America is well launched into an era of amazing madness. Bootlegging has grown from small individual effort to big business embodying huge coalitions and combines. The chase after huge profits is followed closely by their inevitable partners, corruption, violence, and murder. A new and horrible tool appears, the Tommy, a light, deadly, wasp-like machine gun, and murder henceforth is parceled out in wholesale lots.
Illustrating the insanity of prohibition, at one point, the Treasury Department began poisoning industrial alcohols in an attempt to prevent bootlegging. An estimated 10,000 people died from drinking denatured alcohol. In common with the later war on drugs, working class people were the primary targets of police. As historian Elizabeth Cohen noted, a rich family could have a cellar full of liquor and get by. But if a poor family had one bottle of homebrew, there would be trouble. Women's groups had been the primary champions of prohibition, but the female sex was by no means united on the issue. When Ella Boole, the leader of the WCTU, declared that prohibition represented the women of America, some women began organizing in defiance. A wealthy socialite named Pauline Sabin founded the Women's Organization for National Prohibition Reform. It would become a major force in turning the tide of public opinion against the dry forces. In the meantime, speakeasies serving outlawed liquor became the hangouts of choice for both the poor and the rich. Illegal drinking establishments took on a romantic character. Hollywood projected scenes of glitz and glamour in movie houses across the country. A new magazine, The New Yorker, published reviews of swanky nightclubs and jazz musicians. Judging from the dominant media, the American people were having a grand old time. Yet behind the scenes was the less than glamorous lifestyle of the average man and woman. Workers were not only suffering from a decrease in bargaining power, but a decrease in autonomy on the factory floor. Manufacturing had been undergoing a revolution in the methods of production. Between 1914 and 1927, productivity shot up by 55% in iron and steel, 178% in auto manufacturing, and 292% in rubber. The United States now accounted for nearly half of the world's industrial output. But the gargantuan profits did not trickle down to the workers at the bottom. Although the 1920s did see a rise in living standards for a significant portion of Americans, the majority continued to live below the poverty line. In 1929, economists estimated that $2,500 a year was the minimum income necessary to support a family. Yet more than 60% of the nation's families earned less than $2,000 a year. In fact, over 40% earned less than $1,500 annually. Advancements in technology also led to the dislocation of American farmers. New machines, such as combine harvesters and tractors, reduced the need for farmhands. And the oversupply of food caused agricultural prices to drop by up to 60%. Thousands of small farmers suffered foreclosures. As huge agro-businesses bought up the land, the dispossessed moved into cities where, for the first time, the majority of Americans now lived. There, they would find a profoundly dehumanizing form of work.
Small engines needed a new type of precision. The skilled men who built them belonged to craft unions and worked at their own pace. Despite the manufacturer's hopes, this was not to be the century of the motorbike.
Another part of the story is the way work itself was changing in the United States. Under the influence of Frederick Winslow Taylor, who was the founder of scientific management, the influence of Henry Ford, who introduced the assembly line, that most of the jobs that were being created were unskilled jobs, dangerous jobs, hard jobs, and employers felt that they could hire workers at very low wages for these jobs. Taylor tells the story of going to this factory in Philadelphia and looking for the most ambitious worker. And he finds this guy who works really hard, but sees that at the end of the workday, he literally runs home because he's building his own house. And Taylor says, I'm going to introduce my new system by using this guy as an experiment. And I want him to go home too tired to build his own house. I'm going to run him ragged and boost his productivity. And then I'm going to raise his wages so that he can afford to hire somebody else to build his house. That was Taylor's model. And unfortunately for the workers, the employers who used Taylor's model often didn't raise the workers' wages, they just raised their productivity.
Taylorism was certainly about de-skilling. It was about studying what skilled workers did to decompose those tasks into their basic elements, and then teaching people to do specific aspects of it without learning the entire set of or array of activities that were involved and are involved for a skilled person. In that sense, it's a mechanism of control, because you dictate to people, well, you do this part of the entire task and you don't do anything else, and you dictate to 8, 10, or 12 people various specific aspects of the whole task, rather than allowing a skilled person to decide how the entire task should be done. So there's very much control involved there. To the degree that this involves de-skilling and involves control, it tends to take power away from workers, it takes power away from, therefore, the collectivity of workers, and therefore makes them less likely to be rebellious, makes them less likely to form various kinds of movements that would operate against, let's say broadly, the capitalist system. Henry Ford, in effect, invented the automobile assembly line and more generally the system that came to be known as Fordism. One aspect of Fordism had to do with hierarchical control over workers, and more specifically, the control over workers by the assembly line. Before the assembly line, you might have a skilled worker or a set of skilled workers who put the various parts of an automobile together and made a car. The innovation in Ford's case was to create a series of highly specialized tasks next to one another on a very long assembly line. So all a worker might do, for example, is put a hubcap on a car as that car went past as it was being constructed on the assembly line. So instead of a thinking, creative, skilled worker, you had a kind of mindless kind of worker who repetitively did the same task over and over again. Well, that kind of worker is robot-like. You are forced into a series of robot-like actions. And of course, what that meant was that it was only a matter of time until the automobile assembly line and all assembly lines would be taken over by mechanical robots. Because in the end, if all you're asking a human being to be is a human robot, ultimately, when costs are low enough, a mechanical robot is going to be more effective than a human robot.
As we see the development of Taylorism and Fordism and the growth of assembly lines and mass production and efforts to rely less and less on skilled workers, many of these workers are confronted with the choice. Do they see the handwriting on the wall and that the only way to really make their lives secure is to begin organizing with the lesser skilled workers? For a period of time, they tried to hang on to their separateness from other workers. This wonderful character named Big Bill Haywood, who led the industrial workers of the world, would sarcastically refer to the American Federation of Labor as the American Separation of Labor.
The elitism of Henry Ford was also embraced by the broader intellectual class. Liberal intellectual Walter Lippmann crystallized elite opinion. The common interests very largely elude public opinion entirely and can be managed only by a specialized class whose personal interests reach beyond the locality. Evidently, they were not up to the task. The Federal Reserve Bank had been established in 1913 with the stated goal of preventing capital speculation and bank runs. Yet only 16 years later, on October 29, 1929, the stock market underwent the greatest crash in American history, beginning the period known as the Great Depression. Shortly before the collapse, the gangster Al Capone said of Wall Street, "It's a racket. Those stock market guys are crooked."
The top 1% of society had a great time during the 1920s because what they did was to what's called leverage money that they had accumulated with a business or whatever, and then use that to make what is today called a public offering and sell stocks of companies that did not in fact exist, and then take that money and borrow more money on top of it and repeat the process again. And this was legal, and it was in its own way, for as long as it worked, a way to accumulate a great deal of wealth in a very short time. The fundamental problem with such strategies is that there's nothing underneath them. This is moving money around, using money to create more money. But there's no actual productive capacity, there's no actual goods in the more traditional sense of the term to support that. And sooner or later, that spiral breaks.
The tremendous crowds which you see gathered outside the stock exchange are due to the greatest crash in the history of the New York Stock Exchange in market prices. Thank you.
Nazi panic, in my opinion, is over. It had to come. Stock speculation had become crazy. Like an appendix operation, it's a good thing to have it over with. I personally have been buying stocks since the crash set in on Tuesday.
During the Great Depression, the American people received no quarter from the capitalist class. In fact, business leaders used the threat of unemployment to further drive down wages. Within a year, earnings had fallen by 20% across all industries. The growing number of slums became known as Hoovervilles, named after the feckless U.S. president, Herbert Hoover. During Hoover's presidency, more than 13 million Americans lost their jobs. By 1933, fully 24% of the population was unemployed. Two out of every five banks collapsed, causing $7 billion to seemingly evaporate into thin air. Remarkably, some capitalists regarded the Great Depression as a positive development. Hoover's Treasury Secretary, Andrew Mellon, himself one of the wealthiest men in the country, stated that it will purge the rottenness out of the system. People will work harder, live a moral life. Values will be adjusted, and enterprising people will pick up the wrecks from less competent people. Yet the capitalist system did not self-correct, and in 1933, the worst drought in American history struck the Great Plains. So-called black blizzards, massive clouds of dirt a mile high, swarmed through Oklahoma, Kansas, and Texas. Where once grass had anchored the soil, overplowing had left the land defenseless against wind erosion. Desperate families tried to escape the Dust Bowl by traveling west, only to find that jobs were scarce everywhere. About a third of the new arrivals ended up in California's agricultural valleys, where they worked alongside Mexican migrant workers. Living in squalid makeshift communities known as Okievilles, they were viciously exploited by contractors. Firms conspired with growers to drive down their already meager wages. Dozens of major agricultural strikes occurred in California during the early 30s, but few gains were made. Growers were able to drive a wedge between Mexican and native-born workers. And most people were too desperate to remain out of work for long. The struggle in Depression-era California was immortalized by the great American author and socialist, John Steinbeck, in his novel, The Grapes of Wrath.
You know what I've been thinking about? About Casey, about what he said, what he done, about how he died. remember all of it.
He was a good man.
I've been thinking about us, too. About our people living like pigs and good, rich land laying fallow. Or maybe one guy with 1,000,000 acres and 100,000 farmers starving. And I've been wondering if all our folks got together and yelled.
Oh, Tommy, they drive you out and cut you down just like they done to Casey.
They drive me anyways. Sooner or later they get me for one thing, if not for another. Until then.
Tommy, you're not aiming to kill nobody.
No, Ma, not that. That ain't it.
Then what, Tom?
Then it don't matter. I'll be all around in the dark. I'll be everywhere. Wherever you can look. Wherever there's a fight so hungry people can eat, I'll be there. Wherever there's a cop beating up a guy, I'll be there. I'll be in the way guys yell when they're mad. I'll be in the way kids laugh when they're hungry and they know supper's ready. And when the people are eating the stuff they raise and living in the houses they build, I'll be there too.
Living conditions in the cities were no less dire. Starving workers resorted to eating berries, dandelions, and pokeweed. In Chicago, dozens of men fought over a barrel of garbage. Zoo animals were shot and the meat given to the poor. The lack of effective labor representation also led to tragedies in the workplace. From 1927 to 1932, a tunnel was constructed near Gully Bridge, West Virginia, to generate electricity for a plant at Alloy. Reinhardt and Dennis, a subsidiary of the Union Carbide Corporation, failed to provide workers with breathing equipment or even protective masks. Hundreds of workers later died from the lung disease silicosis.
Finely pulverized granite is put into bags to be used as asphalt filler or other uses. This machine is being operated in such a way that the workman must breathe in clouds of harmful dust. And this man is totally unprotected. The foundry shakeout, wherein castings are removed from the molds, is also a dusty operation. These two men are working without any protection whatsoever. They are potential silicosis victims. Here is a typical American workman, one of the million who are dangerously exposed to silica dust. His name is John Steele. Once a master molder, he is still working in this foundry after years of exposure to silica. Once strong and healthy, John Steele is now weak and emaciated. He is short of breath. He cannot do even this work properly. Tells him that he is sick, incompetent, can no longer do a day's work, and that he must let him go. He hands John his last time slip. As a result of his disability, John, like thousands of others, is being fired. He is paid off. Broken in health and in spirit, out of a job, he must seek work elsewhere. John Steele was more fortunate than many another silicosis victim. He was able to find work in a tombstone shed, work which was not too heavy, and where he could earn a little money to help support his family. But he is still exposed to the enemy. Across John Steele's mind flashes his fate. How soon will it become a stark reality? How soon will he join the thousands of others who have succumbed to silica dust?
Despite their severe demoralization, some workers attempted to fight back. In Detroit, socialists organized a march of unemployed workers on the Ford Motor Company complex at River Rouge. They were brutally attacked.
Violence has been a very important factor in controlling working people in the United States, from intimidation to outright repression. Sometimes that violence has come from the government and at different levels. The National Guard at the level of the state, sheriff's deputies and police at the level of local governments. Union organizers have been thrown in jail and prison. Picket lines have been broken up. Courts have provided injunctions. Lots of ways that the government has been a source of violence against working people. Powerful employers have also used violence against working people. They have hired private detective companies. They have hired private security guards. There were notorious detective companies like the Pinkertons or the Baldwin Phelps Company, which was active in the mining fields of West Virginia. And Henry Ford, who, you know, most of the people who became captains of industry in the United States had character structures, we might say, that are pretty dictatorial and autocratic. That's how they got to the top and how they stayed on the top. Henry Ford was probably the worst. Henry Ford introduced the assembly line, measured workers' work down by the second, had industrial engineers figuring out how to keep workers busy, busy, busy. Even in the 1920s, hired what he called the sociology department, whose job was to visit workers in their homes and to see how they spent the wages. Did they buy alcohol? Did they buy tobacco? Did they subscribe to socialist newspapers? And Henry Ford's social workers would go out and spy on workers, and they were hated and feared. In the workplace, Ford turned to a guy named Harry Bennett and gave Harry Bennett the resources to organize a private security force that policed Ford's plants, that spied on workers' meetings. There were stories that, you know, maybe you weren't safe in the bathroom, that maybe they had drilled holes in the wall and were listening to what people were saying when they were sitting on the toilet. Workers were terrified of Harry Bennett and his thugs, as they were referred to. When Ford began to close plants in the early 30s, and workers began to protest and to demand either that the plants remain open or that they be provided with food and some sort of unemployment benefits, Bennett's armed guards often broke those demonstrations up. In the Ford Hunger March at the River Rouge plant, those armed guards opened fire and killed several of the workers who were marching to demand food.
In the same year as the Hunger March in Detroit, almost 50,000 people, led by 17,000 World War I veterans, marched on Washington. The veterans demanded cash payment of bonuses promised to them in 1924. After the marchers set up encampments, President Hoover ordered the U.S. Army to clear them out. The assault was led by Army Chief of Staff Douglas MacArthur, who went on to become a celebrated general during World War II. MacArthur used infantry, cavalry, and 6 tanks to attack the veterans and their families, killing 2 men. Their shelters and belongings were then burned. Workers across the country looked to the union movement for support, but organized labor remained weak and divided. The AFL continued to represent mostly skilled workers, while the American Communist Party was plagued by the same factionalism that had overtaken the Soviet Union. In 1927, Joseph Stalin secured control of the Russian Communist Party, expelling his rival, Leon Trotsky, from the Politburo. Trotsky was forced into exile. He was eventually assassinated in Mexico on August 20, 1940. Nevertheless, workers in the U.S. were beginning to organize from the ground up. In January 1933, 15,000 auto workers went on strike. In the same year, meatpackers in Austin, Minnesota, not only struck, but occupied their factory. The sit-down strike was an innovation of the Wobblies. First used at a General Electric plant in 1906, the tactic was described by the anarchist Lucy Parsons. Workers shouldn't strike and go out and starve, but strike and remain in and take possession of the means of production. The plant's owner, Don Hermel, asked Governor Floyd B. Olson to send in the National Guard. However, in a rare example of an American politician expressing solidarity with radical labor, the governor refused. The Hormel Company was forced into arbitration. Workers received a substantial wage increase as well as recognition of their union. While most politicians were content to let the American people suffer, a small number embraced left-wing populism. Among them was Huey Long, nicknamed the Kingfish, who served as governor and later senator for the state of Louisiana. During his tenure, Long built hospitals for the poor, created night schools for the illiterate, revised tax codes to increase the burden on the rich, and offered free textbooks to schoolchildren. He advocated not only a minimum wage, but a maximum wage. He supported the idea that every man and woman should have the right to housing, medical care, and fulfilling work. He opposed the Federal Reserve banking system. And he was despised by the rich.
I can't remember any Saturday night that I went anywhere that we didn't talk about killing Huey Long. It was a normal conversation. I suppose that the very strong pro-Long people weren't talking that way, but the antis certainly. It didn't mean you meant to do it. It just meant that you wished that there was some way to rid the state of this incubus.
The Lord has answered the prayer. He has called the barbecue. Come to my feast. He said to 125 million American people. But Morgan and Rockefeller and Miller and Baruch have walked up and took 85% of the victuals off the table. Now, how are you going to feed the balance of the people? What's Morgan and Baruch and Rockefeller and Mellon going to do with all that grub? They can't eat it. They can't wear the clothes. They can't live in the house. Give them a yacht. Give them a palace. Send them to Reno and give them a new wife when they want it. That's what they want. But when they've got everything on the God's living earth that they can eat and they can wear and they can live in, and all that their children can live in and wear and eat and all their children's children can use, then we got to call Mr. Morgan and Mr. Mellon and Mr. Rockefeller back and say, come back here. Where's that stuff back on this table here that you took away from here that you don't need? Any men ever went to a barbecue?
and would let one man take off the table what's intended for 9/10 of the people to eat. The only way you'll ever be able to feed the balance of the people is to make that man come back and bring back some of that grub he ain't got no business with.
Long had ambitions for the White House. By 1935, he had come to be regarded by Franklin Delano Roosevelt as one of the biggest threats to a second term as president. Long was struck down by an assassin's bullet. On September 10, 1935, he was murdered by a disgruntled doctor named Carl Weiss. Long's last words were, "God, don't let me die. I have so much to do."
The hour came on the historic 4th of March to tell the people frankly and courageously that there had to be a new deal. From the inaugural platform erected upon the east front of the majestic Capitol, the president made his speech of acceptance as 150,000 looked on and as 50 million listened in by radio.
This is a day of national consecration. And I am certain that on this day, my fellow Americans, that on my induction into the presidency, I will address them with a candor and a decision which the present situation of our people impels. This is preeminently the time to speak the truth and boldly.
Roosevelt's populism was several shades less radical than that of Huey Long. A true conservative corrects injustices to preserve social peace, he stated. I am the best friend the profit system ever had. The salvation of American capitalism.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the president in the 1930s, was, of course, the scion of one of the richest, most prominent families from the colonial times all the way to the 1900s. And so one of his cousins, of course, was Theodore Roosevelt, who was a Republican president. Two wings of the same family, a perfect illustration of the two-party system, the way that that works. Congress members saying things like, if we don't do something, that the doors to revolution will be thrown open. The initial things that he did in the first 100 days, which has kind of become the legendary standpoint, in which every successive administration is sort of measured by, he did push through the Congress, a fairly heavily Democratic Congress, a huge set of policies that, given today's Congress, that can't seem to pass anything, it would be amazing in and of itself. And some of those were fairly fundamental reforms.
Roosevelt launched a huge number of initiatives under the New Deal. These included the allotment of $500 million for emergency relief to the poor, agricultural aid to farmers, the creation of a public works administration to employ everyone from construction workers to artists, and the establishment of the Tennessee Valley Authority to build dams on the Tennessee River. The National Industry Recovery Act placed restrictions on child labor, established minimum wage and maximum hour laws, and most importantly, codified the right of American workers to unionize and strike. Union organizers immediately set into action. The Amalgamated Clothing Workers doubled its membership from 60,000 to 120,000 between early 1933 and mid-1934. The United Mine Workers of America quadrupled its membership from 100,000 to 400,000. During the same time period. In 1933, there were almost 1,700 work stoppages, double that of the previous year. Fearing revolution from below, and skeptical that laissez-faire capitalism could stabilize the economy, some American elites actually supported Roosevelt's reforms. Others claimed he was a dictator or enabler of bureaucratic overreach. Still others looked fondly upon the growing fascist movement in Europe. These contradictions within the capitalist class led to a brazen attempt at a military putsch.
I appeared before the Congressional Committee, the highest representation of the American people, under subpoena to tell what I knew of activities which I believe might lead to an attempt to set up a fascist dictatorship.
In 1933, the decorated U.S. Marine Corps General Smedley Butler was approached by a representative from the banking firm Grayson, Murphy & Company. He was promised $3 million to lead a march of veterans on Washington, modeled after the bonus march of the previous year. This time, the veterans would not be asking for a small amount of money. They would be seizing the reins of power. According to Butler, the plot's backers included some of America's wealthiest men. But the plotters had picked the wrong Marine. After a life of service in the military, Butler had grown disillusioned with American foreign as well as domestic policy. "I spent 33 years being a high-class muscle man for big business, for Wall Street and the bankers," he said. "In short, I was a racketeer, a gangster for capitalism."
The plan as outlined to me was to form an organization of veterans, to use as a bluff or as a club at least, to intimidate the government and break down our democratic institutions. The upshot of the whole thing was that I was supposed to lead an organization of 500,000 men, which would be able to take over the functions of government. I talked with an investigator for this committee who came to me with a subpoena on Sunday, November 18th. He told me they had unearthed evidence linking my name with several such veteran organizations. As it then seemed to me to be getting serious, I felt it was my duty to tell all I knew of such activities to this committee. My main interest in all this is to preserve our democratic institution. I want to retain the right to vote. I have the right to speak freely and the right to write. If we maintain these basic principles, our democracy is safe. No dictatorship can exist with suffrage, freedom of speech and press.
The response by the establishment press to the exposure of the so-called business plot was one of mockery. The New York Times claimed it was a gigantic hoax and a bald and unconvincing narrative. The mayor of New York dismissed it as a cocktail putsch. Yet a later congressional investigation determined that the plot was indeed real. The committee report stated, "Certain persons made an attempt to establish a fascist organization in this country. There is no question that these attempts were discussed, were planned, and might have been placed in execution when and if the financial backers deemed it expedient." While some factions of the ruling class were busy scheming to install a fascist dictatorship, working class people were busy fighting for a living wage.
...1934 was a very important year in American labor history that saw workers in a number of places organize massive strikes in response to the poverty of the Great Depression, to the ways that those who even still had jobs found employers cutting their wages again and again, threatening them that they could be replaced by somebody who was even more desperate. So 1934 saw this great strike in Minneapolis of truck drivers and warehouse workers. a great strike in San Francisco of longshore workers and warehouse workers, a great strike in Toledo of workers who made auto parts, and a great strike across the South in the textile industry. And one of the things that makes it so interesting was that the textile industry had only come to the South running away from workers' unions, strikes, and organizing in Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Connecticut, Rhode Island, and it really was the first runaway industry, moved from New England to the South, where they took advantage of racial divisions in the workforce to control the white workers that they employed in the textile mills. But in 1934, those white workers, many of them women, organized and launched this great strike to demand union recognition and living wages. They failed, but they set a tremendous standard and inspiration for other workers in the South and in the textile industry.
In 1934, textile workers up and down the East Coast, I mean many thousands of workers, went out on strike. Basically, you know, one factory would shut down and the workers would all basically go from town to town. There were like factory towns at the time, calling out other workers on strike, and then workers in that plant would also walk off the job and come on strike, and the crowd would grow. I mean, we're talking about the self-activity of the working class at its most effective.
The textile strike of 1934 began in North Carolina on Labor Day, when 65,000 workers walked off the job. A few days later, 200,000 workers joined them. Ultimately, the strike would involve 500,000 workers from New England to the mid-Atlantic states to the southern states. The New York Times warned, "The grave danger of the situation is that it will get completely out of the hands of the leaders." For workers, it was the other way around. The real danger was posed by business leaders and their representatives in government.
The way rulers responded was with some of the worst bloody violence in U.S. history. I mean, just coming in and shooting down peaceful pickets, bayoneting in the South, bayoneting, using bayonets to kill strikers who were wearing, ironically, peaceful picket buttons on them when they were found dead.
The extreme violence directed against the textile workers made a mockery of working people's alleged right to strike. In fact, it had been Democratic governors in 12 states that had themselves called out the militia. Rhode Island UTW leader Frank Gorman stated, "We know now that we are naive to depend on the forces of government to protect us." Despite the tragedy of the textile strike, union activity continued to grow as radical labor organizers emerged in every major industry. Writing of the time period, labor historian Sidney Lenz noted that one or two leftists among 1,000 workers was enough to give the group direction and stimulus.
The Toledo strike in 34 was against the Toledo Auto Light Company. And, you know, in each of these cases, I think it's important to say that radicals of one kind or another were elected to the leadership. They were very democratic. The first one was the American Workers' Party, which was led by A.J. Mustey. And they had the ingenious idea of mobilizing unemployed people to join the picket lines. That kept the unemployed from scabbing or strike breaking on the strike. It brought them into the struggle. And essentially, that is how the Toledo Autolite strike was won.
Roy W. Howard of Scripps Howard Newspapers wrote of the new tactic with amazement bordering on incredulity. The unemployed appeared on the picket lines to help striking employees win a strike, though you would expect their interests would lie the other way, that is, in going in and getting the jobs the other men had laid down. A series of arrests followed, and on May 24th, Ohio Governor George White sent in the National Guard. It was the largest peacetime mobilization in Ohio's history. Despite the presence of hundreds of troops, the crowd refused to budge. Even after two workers were killed by gunfire, the demonstrators fought back with bricks, stones, and their own fists. The refusal of workers and the unemployed to disperse, combined with the looming threat of a general strike, provoked the intervention of Department of Labor mediators. The auto parts makers agreed to a wage increase, recognition of the union, and the rehiring of workers. During the same year, 1934, two more massive strikes occurred, one in San Francisco and the other in Minneapolis. Both were reminiscent of the Seattle General Strike of 1919, during which workers had effectively taken over the entire city, creating parallel governing structures and providing services for workers, their families, and the public at large. The strike by longshoremen in San Francisco was motivated by the so-called shape-up, a system of hiring they referred to as the slave market. In the words of labor historian Jeremy Brecker, every morning at 6 a.m., longshoremen would crowd along the embarcadero, where the foreman would pick out those they wanted for the day. The effect was that longshoremen could never count on steady work, had to suck up to or even bribe the foreman, and had to work to exhaustion or not be hired again. On May 9th, longshoremen from San Francisco to Seattle went on strike, cutting off nearly 2,000 miles of coastland. They were soon joined by other maritime workers, including sailors, marine firemen, cooks, and stewards. Several months of bitter and increasingly violent struggle followed. Then, the governor of California sent in the National Guard. At that point, unions across the city decided to join the maritime workers in solidarity.
Efforts of business interests to forcibly open the strike-paralyzed port of San Francisco failed. Open warfare rages through the streets of the city as 3,000 Union pickets battle 700 police. Guns, tear gas, clubs, and fists bring injuries to more than 80 persons and cause the death of two. Listen to the strikers' side of the story.
We are asking for a general strike to keep organized labor on the Pacific Coast. We are not only asking for it, but we're going to get it.
Then, with a general strike and additional violence threatened, 2,500 guardsmen move in, commanded by Colonel Mittelstate.
The California National Guard has been ordered into active service by our governor for the purpose of maintaining law and order in San Francisco and protecting life and property. This we propose to do at any cost.
These idle ships and piers have more than local significance. They are symbols of wasted millions and represent a backward step in our recovery program.
Virtually all of San Francisco's unions voted to join the general strike, Two exceptions were the bakery and milk wagon drivers, whose services were deemed essential by all concerned. More than 100,000 workers walked off the job.
Mayor Rossi states the position of his administration.
I must insist, first, that law and order shall prevail. Second, that those desiring to furnish the people of San Francisco with the necessities of life must be permitted to do so without hindrance. Third, that the municipal government must continue to function. The general public must and shall be served.
Though violence occurred on both sides, the strike was ultimately defeated, not by police or the National Guard, but by the union leadership itself. Their betrayal was mirrored by the Roosevelt administration. New Deal Administrator Hugh Johnson publicly condemned the labor actions in San Francisco.
You are living out here under the stress of a general strike. Now the right of dissatisfied men to strike against a recalcitrant employer is inviolate. But the general strike is quite another matter. That is a threat to the community. That is a menace to government. That is civil war.
On the first day of the general strike, AFL President William Green joined government officials in disavowing it. On the second day, the General Strike Committee called for arbitration of all issues. On the third, it reopened all union restaurants and butcher shops while ending embargoes on gasoline and fuel oil. Lacking bargaining power, the longshoremen who had begun the strike were forced to return to work with their demands unmet. The so-called slave market would continue. The sheriff of Minneapolis would later write of the Great Teamster Strike of 1934. They had the whole town tied up tight. Not a truck could move. The head of the Teamsters, Dan Tobin, opposed the strike for its duration, but the local union 574 had ambitious plans. Led by a Trotskyist named Vincent Dunn, they set out to organize the Teamsters on an industrial level. Not only would truck drivers be involved, but anyone connected to the delivery process. The workers used sophisticated techniques in the battles that followed. They monitored police radios, gave instructions in code, and created disguised patrols to locate and subdue potential strikebreakers. At the same time, the Teamsters made sure that hospitals were kept running and food delivered to the hungry. A committee of 100 rank-and-file strikers was elected to direct day-to-day activities. Women created their own auxiliary group to organize demonstrations at City Hall, nurse injured strikers, and prepare meals. The Teamsters had massive support among other Minneapolis workers. 35,000 building trades workers walked out in sympathy, as did the city's taxi drivers. The Farm Holiday Association, a militant farmers group, provided contributions of food. Hundreds of non-Teamster workers showed up at strike headquarters daily to offer their services. Business leaders responded by using an astroturf organization called the Citizens' Army. Some of its members were deputized as special police. The Citizens' Army attacked Teamsters in the Central Market. they were not prepared for what followed. The next day, workers fought back with military precision. A strike leader explained. In the market itself, pickets without union buttons were placed in key positions. When that was accomplished, the signal was given, and the 600 men poured out of Central Labor Union headquarters. They marched to the market in military formation, four abreast with their clubs. Teamsters continued to engage not only in militant activities, but outreach to the community. They created a newspaper whose readership shot up to 10,000 in 2 days. And they maintained support from farmers by allowing them to create their own markets in town. For a short time, it seemed as though the strike had been won, but negotiations broke down. On July 6th, the largest mass meeting in Minneapolis history occurred when farmer and labor groups organized a march in solidarity. On July 20th, police attacked workers at the market. 2 men were killed and another 76 wounded.
The pickup in which Ness is riding moves quickly to intercept the truck. Standing by, a line of policemen are ready with their shotguns.
We heard the shooting. It was in the middle of the block. The truck would have tried to intercept the truck, I'm sure. That was the intent. But nobody got out of the truck, and the pictures will show police started open fire on it. Harry and I and Ben Kosky, and I remember Ben because we were all three injured, come out of that alley, and we ran into a policeman who was down on one knee, and he had a Sub Thompson machine riot gun, and just as we come around the corner, he fired. And he knocked Harry DeBoer's leg. We didn't know how bad, but Harry fell down. Ben Kosky's hand was right next to Harry's leg, and he pretty near severed it, and I got the balance of the charge, lacerations in the stomach area, and I got some cracked ribs out of it. I thought I was killed because I was bleeding, but it was just surface wounds, it turned out to be. We got Harry, got him up to the strike headquarters, we got Kosky there, and everyone went to different hospitals. Then came a terrible period of not frustration, but anger among the ranks. And the leaders had a problem because they were a real concern that several of the guys would want to get even with that. That was cold-blooded murder, what they done. It was cold-blooded murder.
40-year-old Henry Ness, a World War I veteran and father of four, was the first to die from his injuries. A few days later, tens of thousands of Minneapolis citizens lined the streets for his funeral. Public opinion swayed in favor of the Teamsters, and it was at this point that Governor Floyd B. Olson decided to call in the National Guard. Olson was the same governor who had refused to send in the Guard against meatpackers in Austin after they occupied their plant the previous year. Having first declared, "I am not a liberal, I am a radical," he balked when faced with what seemed like a real possibility of mass revolt. Labor leaders were arrested and imprisoned in a makeshift camp. However, as the historian Charles Walker wrote, The strike's conduct had been such that 1,000 lesser leaders had come out of the ranks. The arrest of the leaders, instead of beheading the movement, infused it with demoniac fury. In the face of an implacable foe, Governor Olson and the broader business community decided to cut their losses. Imprisoned strike leaders were released, and the Teamsters' demands were met.
I think that the context is important. This year, 1934, these great, broad, quasi, if not fully general strikes in Minneapolis, in Toledo, in San Francisco, and across the South in the textile industry. And these strikes led to critical developments in 1935, such as the birth of the CIO, of a new kind of union, the industrial union, rather than the craft unions of the American Federation of Labor. And so these strikes in 1934 laid a foundation in workers' experiences and in workers conceptualizing what kind of union do we need to be powerful in relationship to these employers and to the government. And so these strikes gave birth to this new form of union and led the United States Congress to pass a law called the National Labor Relations Act in 1935, also known as the Wagner Act because it was written by Senator Robert Wagner of New York, which provided a peaceful mechanism whereby workers could gain union recognition. They would sign cards. An organization called the National Labor Relations Board, established by the government, would review those cards to see if they were legitimate. Then if they were, they would conduct an election. The election would have a secret ballot. And if the workers voted by secret ballot to have a union, the employer would be required to negotiate with that union. All of those developments in 1935 grew out of what had happened in 1934.
You can tell them in the country, tell them in the town. The miners down in Mingo laid their shovels down. We won't pull another pillow. Another ton or lift another finger till the union we have won. Stand up, boys, let the bosses know. Turn your buckets over, turn your lanterns low. There's fire in our hearts and fire in our soul, but there ain't gonna be no fire in the hole. Daddy died a miner, Grandpa he did too. I'll bet this coal will kill me before my working days is through. In a hole that's dark and dirty, an early grave confined, I plan to make a union for the ones I leave behind. Stand up, boys, let the bosses know. Turn your buckets over, turn your lanterns.